Okay, brilliant. Well, thanks very much for the invite to be here. It's great to see you and have such a good audience, even though I know it's still early days after the holidays. So thanks everybody for turning up. As Alvin was saying, this work is social science research. Hopefully that doesn't send you all running from the room. And I should say, although the introduction said that I was originally a physical climate scientist, that was a very long time ago. And I'm definitely now in the environmental social sciences. So don't give me any hard questions. However, if you want to talk about epistemology or theory, I'm your woman. So what I'm going to be presenting today is a work that's going to be coming out in Nature Climate Change, actually as part of a special issue on the mediatisation of the IPCC report. So it's looking actually about how the IPCC was communicated, what was done well, what could have been done better, what the challenges are for communicating climate science, and making useful science for policy. So I've looked at all three working groups, working group one, two and three. I know a lot of you will be more familiar with working group one. And the special issue as a whole also looks at social media coverage of the IPCC, looks at TV coverage in developed and developing nations. And it gives a number of recommendations for how the IPCC might move forward in the future if there were to be another working group report or set of reports. The work I'm going to be looking at is how the IPCC was represented in the media. So it's looking at legacy media, so that's newspapers, print media and TV broadcasts. It looks at US and UK media, and it also looks at social media coverage through looking at Twitter. And a lot of that work was led by my colleague Dr. Hal Williams at the University of Exeter. So this is a real collaboration across various different people. Also Dr. Tim Kurtz, who's a psychologist, and professor, associate professor Max Boykoff, who's based at the University of Colorado in Boulder. Okay, so why look at media representations then? Well, people rely upon media representations to help kind of interpret the climate science society policy interface. It's one of the major sources of information for people about climate change. And we know that how the media represent climate change has a big influence on the way that people think about the issue. That's not to say that people are kind of empty vessels, that you kind of open up somebody's head, pour some information in, and then they go away and act exactly as you'd like them to. A lot of the social science research that we're involved with shows how there's a really convoluted relationship, if you like, between information and people's behaviour. And in the way of those two things becomes people's values and attitudes, cultural understandings about what's the right or the good thing to do. And all of these things have an influence on how people might eventually act. So giving more information doesn't necessarily lead to what you might think is the right behaviour. Perhaps the best example of this is climate scientists who know all about climate change and yet go off flying around the world to conferences, which is not, that's not a critique at all, but it's to say that there is this disjunct between what our knowledge is about climate change and potentially our behaviours. So yeah, there's no straightforward relationship between media and audience. And media messages might conflict with our values, particularly cultural values. But the thing that media do is they help kind of put bounds around what's reasonable to talk about, what we should be concerned about when it comes to climate change. So they can either act to widen the pool of debate by bringing in new sources, new issues, new topics for discussion, or they might constrict it by always referring to the same experts, by talking consistently about one particular type of story, like the climate pause, for example. And so they can, yeah, through these different issues, events, their quotes, the quoted sources, and also journalistic norms. So, for example, of balanced reporting, of always having to show two sides to every story, journalists can act to open up or close down how we think about climate change. So the work that we've been doing has been looking at framing. And in social sciences, framing is a really common concept. It's used across sociology, political science, psychology, and it's got a number of different definitions, some of which are a little bit woolly. So this Gamson and Modigliani one is very commonly used, and it's kind of it says it's the central organising idea or storyline provides meaning to an unfolding strip of events. The frame suggests what the controversy is about, the very sort of essence of an issue. that hopefully gives you a nice understanding of a kind of gut feeling of what a frame might be, how you might frame an issue. But in this particular study, we're concerned with being much more specific about how we measure frames. So we're using the Entman definition. So this is a definition from the communication studies literature. And Entman thinks that to be a frame, you must be able to say that what the problem definition is. So how is the problem defined by this frame? What are the moral judgments that are made within the frame? And either explicitly or implicitly, what are the particular remedies that are kind of advocated by the frame? And their frames are recognisable then through their key elements. So they might be things like metaphors, like for climate change, the IPCC report, it was referred to as a bombshell report, for example, nice metaphor there. Examples, kind of themes like ClimateGate. I say this as somebody who used to work in the climatic research unit. Through key sentences like the greatest moral challenge of our time, hopefully some of you will recognise that. Through key images, good old polar bear, a lot of my work's on climate change communication of imagery. You can't believe how many images of polar bears I get on Christmas cards every year. Or themes, so like the pause in surface temperature warming, for example, key kind of themes that you might see. So to be able to be a frame, we need to be able to recognise these specific things and be able to say what they are. It's not just a kind of gut feeling about what the article is telling us. It's quite more broken down than that.
Saffron, have you done an analysis, of the polar bear imagery to see how many are real and how many? Because I heard a lot of them are photoshopped, actually.
Well, so this is a really interesting thing about visuals, and we have our own visual expert from UNSW here who I met with this morning. And one of the interesting things about images is that people, unlike text, where people think that they kind of, you know, they actively interpret it and they might kind of think, I've read this thing, but I'm not sure if I believe it or not. People tend to look at images and naturally think that what they portray is the real thing. So like you have a photograph and people don't think, oh, somebody's framed that photograph. They've decided to capture that element and not all of these other things. But yeah, so when it comes to polar bears, people often don't realise. And then when there is evidence of photoshopping, there's a real uproar. So I don't know whether you know, there was a letter by Peter Gleick, and others in Science in 2010, I think, writing to the editors saying the integrity of climate science. I think 56 or so climate scientists wrote this article and said, you know, this is a real problem. We need to show how climate science is, you know, is really strong and based on fundamental physics. And then the editor, unbeknown to them, put a picture of a polar bear. It wasn't that one. It was one that's taken from a helicopter, and it has been photoshopped, and it shows a polar bear floating on an ice raft. And you can imagine what that did when people were like, hang on a minute, you've got this photoshopped picture of a polar bear looking like he's in the middle of the ocean, actually he was only metres away from an ice shelf, or whatever, compared to the integrity of climate scientists. So yeah, there's a lot of polar bear imagery out there. I could talk for hours. There's another talk. So we'll leave that one there. So yeah, on the data collection for this framing study, we were interested in looking beyond the normal kind of sources that framing analysis tends to look at. So normally when people do climate media research, there's loads of this stuff out there, people look at print, so only look at newspapers. That's kind of problematic. And when they look at newspapers, they only ever look at the text. And the reason for that is quite straightforward. It's because there's this amazing resource called LexisNexis that you can type in your key search terms and it will spill out all the coverage that's ever existed on those search terms. So you've got your data set ready and waiting for you. But that's kind of problematic, as you kind of alluded to with images. They're really important in shaping how people respond to climate change, well, to any issue actually. We know that when people see polar bears, for example, they're a really cliched, stereotyped image, and they make people feel in very different ways. They're very polarising, actually. So people will look at this and they'll recognise that I'm being mic'd, so I perhaps won't put this quite as I was going to. But they're a stereotyped image, and they'll recognise that this person's having a bit of this journalist having a bit of a joke with them, together with the headline. This is telling a story about how climate science is actually a load of rubbish. But if you only got the text, you wouldn't really know what that, you know, that story was trying to portray, or you wouldn't have the rich kind of visual detail of the printed page. And the other thing about looking at just at print, at newspapers, is that actually very few people use newspapers as a major source of news. So only, I think, 11%, this is a Reuters Institute study on where people access their news, which I really recommend it, it's very interesting. Only 11% of people access news from print, from newspapers. If you look at who accesses news online, for people under 30 or under 35, that's their main source of news. So social media, online media, is a major source of news for under 35s. And for people generally, TV news is the major source of news. So if we're interested in what people engage with on an everyday basis, then looking at print only is not terribly useful. It's much better to do it in conjunction with TV and with social media. So this is how we kind of got to where we got to with our data collection. We wanted to look across all working groups. So previous studies have only looked at one particular working group. People tend to look at working group one. I've done a lot of work on climate change adaptation, so I'm most interested in looking at working group two. There's been very little actually on working group three, so we also wanted to collect across all three. We're interested in doing a cross-cultural analysis, so looking both at the UK and at the US, which both are major players in climate policy, both have contrarian voices, both have incredibly powerful media organisations like the New York Times, The Guardian, which are agenda-setting in their own countries and beyond. So there's various reasons for choosing those two countries. And we're also interested in not only legacy media, so those kind of really major old news media, but also social media news as well. So we chose these newspapers to represent a spread across newspaper types, so tabloid, broadsheet, and also different ideologies, so left wing to right wing. So The Guardian, The Telegraph, The Daily Mail, The Mirror and The Sun in the UK, and The LA Times, New York Times, USA Today, Wall Street Journal and The Washington Post in the US. We also collected the major nightly broadcast of each of the major news channels in those two countries. So that was the BBC, the ITV and Channel 4 News in the UK, and ABC, CBS, NBC, CNN and Fox News in the US. And we also looked at Twitter as our social media source. Of course, there are loads of different ways you could look at social media. Social scientists are only just starting to kind of get to grips with how to analyse social media. So a lot of work, well, most of the work that exists in this area is actually done on Twitter for various reasons, which I could talk about in questions. So for all of those things, all of those sources, we collected media items, so a newspaper article, the major nightly news broadcast, the one with the biggest audience, or the individual tweet, and we any of those that were substantively about the IPCC, we collected those. And the data collection period was over a fortnight, centred on the day of the working group press release. So a week before the press release, a week after the press release. And we analysed each item, so each tweet, each article, each broadcast, for its primary frame. We did also look at secondary frames, but I'm not going to be talking about that today. So how did we develop the, well, what's called the issue frame schema? So you remember how I defined the frame, as it's got its moral judgment, its implicit or explicit solutions. Well, the first thing to do was to look across the climate change media literature, the social science literature, about anyone who'd done any kind of work on climate change framing. So these are eight different studies, all of which do a climate change framing analysis, looking at various different media. And this is just a snapshot of a table, which is printed in full, obviously, in the article, but I can't fit it all on the page. But you can see there are various different frames here: settled science, disaster, the economic frame, uncertainty frame. And some studies use these, some of those frames. Some of them have other ones that kind of split it up a little bit. And there's some kind of overlap, but none of them had all of these frames kind of all together, if you like. So this is a way of kind of meta-analysis, mapping the literature to see what frames people had seen existed in the literature already. The second part of that analysis to try and develop this frame schema, so the first was to look at a meta-analysis of what existed already in the social science literature. The second was work that we've previously done on public engagement with climate change, so audience work. So to ask people the images or the themes that they held in their head when they thought about climate change, what were the things that came into their mind? So from that work, we also knew the kind of frames that existed in people's heads already. And the third thing we did was, from our knowledge of political science and climate change policy and the kind of socio-cultural context around climate change, was to put these in socio-cultural context. So to know where particular frames might have come from, sponsored by, for example, like in the UK, the economic frame arguably was given a really big boost by the Stern Report, and in Australia, and then the Garnet Review. So we can tell that they're sponsored by kind of elite actors. So that there were three different ways to check that we kind of really mapped the field and got a feel for all the different frames that might exist on climate change. So this is to give you a sense of how the frame schema is then defined. So rather than this kind of slightly woolly idea about what a frame is, these are the things that we're looking for in each of those media items, each of those articles or tweets or TV news broadcasts. So the first is the socio-political context of frames, who's sponsoring the frame, what elite actors use the frame, and also how it engages people or not in the public realm. So there's increasingly social science research that tells us how people engage with climate change and what kind of frames help people to feel engaged, and conversely, which frames tend to turn people off or make them feel that they have a lack of self-efficacy, a lack of being able to do something about it. Then we've got the column with the problem definition, the moral judgment and the remedy, the typical sources that might be used. So when you're looking for a newspaper through a newspaper article, for example, if it quotes a lot of scientists and the skeptics are minority voices, then you're likely for it to be a settled science frame. The kind of themes or storylines that you might see coming across. So, for example, in the settled science frame, that the IPCC report was produced by thousands of expert scientists. There's an unprecedented rate of change. It might talk about the carbon budget. It might list impacts, not go into any particular detail about them, but just list them and say how severe and irreversible they were likely to be. The kind of language or metaphors and phrases, key phrases that might be used, like the greatest challenge of our time there. The skeptics might be saying about climate change contrarians, saying that it's just wishful thinking on their part or malpractice. And also the kind of visual imagery that you might expect to see within a particular frame. So in the settled science frame, you might expect to see scientists like kind of in the IPCC fora discussing graph, a particular figure of use, for example, or you might see scientists in the field. You might see pictures of climate impacts and increasingly figures of kind of climate science as well. So hopefully that gives you a sense just for one particular frame about the kind of things we're looking for each of those frames. So when you look at a media item, you're looking for quite a lot of different details about how that frame is constructed. Of course, there isn't only just one frame. There's actually, we found through those three different things, through the mapping of the social science, climate, media, literature, the socio-cultural, political context, and through our public engagement work, that in fact there are 10 different frames that exist across climate change when communicating climate change. So to run through them in brief, the settled science one, I've already detailed a little bit. So that's emphasis on the science of climate change across any of the working groups. So that's not only physical climate science, that could be climate change adaptation science, for example, for working group two. It also emphasises the broad expert scientific consensus and evidence of the need for action. So science has spoken, others must act, and uncertainty or scepticism is quashed. In the next frame is political or ideological struggle. Tend to see this a lot in newspaper opinion articles. So this is about a conflict over the way the world should work. So it's not really a focus on the science here, but it's about solutions or strategy to address climate change above disagreements over the scientific evidence itself. Or it's a battle for power between nations or between kind of elites. The role of science frame, that one looks at the role that science plays in society. So it might discuss how the IPCC works as an institution or doesn't work or could work better. I should say that any of these frames could be a kind of could be used by a contrarian sort of framing or a kind of consensus view. It's not like only role of science is only for consensus science. It could also be used by contrarians. Uncertain science. is a very common frame. It's a focus on uncertainty. In climate science, impacts or solutions, so across all three working groups again. And it might question the anthropogenic nature of climate change or discuss the natural variability. We can't, shouldn't, or will struggle to act. The fifth frame is on disaster, a really common frame for working group two. So predicted impacts are dire and they're likely to get worse. We're not well prepared. Security is a kind of, maybe a subset of disaster in some cases, but we separated it out because we thought it was going to be a really quite a major theme coming out of working group two, and which it did prove to be quite common in working group two. So here, climate change is a threat to human security. So whereas looking at crop yields themselves might be disaster, looking at how crop yields impact on human populations in terms of food shortages would be a security frame. So yeah, it could be energy, water or food security, or a threat to the nation state like through migration. And then there's three different frames here, morality and ethics, opportunity and economic frame, of which for each of them there are two kind of versions. There's a version that says we need to have action, and there's a version that says we don't need to have action. So for morality and ethics, it's a frame around an explicit and urgent moral, religious or ethical call, and we tend to see that through religious leaders, for example, calling for action or not. The opportunity frame says that, you know, on the calling for action says climate change is a way to reimagine how we live our lives, or there's going to be beneficial impacts so we don't need to worry about it. And the economic frame discusses growth and prosperity, investments and markets, similarly, either of two ways. And the very last frame is about climate change and health. So climate change poses danger to human health through malnutrition, air quality, and urgent action is required. You might think that's a very common frame. So, the results then. Well, here's the 14 days centred on the day of IPCC press release. So this is combined for all three working groups. The number of print articles, you can see here, if I use the pointer, there's a real peak here around a day after the working group's reports are released, which is not entirely surprising. But there is some pre and some post those dates. If you look at TV, there's a much more distinct time where you get the coverage. So looking at issue attention, there's a much shorter period of issue attention for TV. It tends to be centred on the day of the press release. There's some amount of coverage in the week prior, but absolutely nothing after the day of press release. And if you look on Twitter, we were looking particularly at the IPCC hashtag. You can see here, we're collecting constantly, actually, the hashtags global warming and climate change. We've actually done some interesting social network maps of who's engaging with those particular hashtags and how they engage. And you can see that you get these big peaks around these grey, that's working group one period here, and this is working group two and three, that shade there, grey shaded area there, that show the peaks in coverage. But they're very quick on Twitter. They happen over about 2 or 3 days, and then it goes back to the background level. So issue attention and it's more spread over print, more concentrated on TV, and again, very concentrated on Twitter. If you look at prominence, one way to look at whether or not an issue is prominent in news is to look at things like front pages, for example, and print, and also on TV about how much coverage an item gets. So you can see across the three working groups, well, the first thing that's really striking is that working group one by far gets the most coverage. Working group two gets a reasonable amount of coverage, and working group three really doesn't get a huge amount of coverage. I'll talk about why that might be towards the end. And if you look at the prominence on those, there's very few front pages for any of the working groups. And if you look at images on front pages, which is a real telltale sign that this is, you know, like a big splash, something that the editor thinks is really important to have out there. In fact, I don't think there were any images across any of the working groups for IPCC coverage. So on newspapers, that's the pattern that we see. That's a combination of the US and the UK data. If you look at the TV coverage, we see a similar pattern. In fact, even more stark, that working group three gets very little coverage at all. I should say that although I've combined both the US and the UK legacy media, print and TV here, the UK gets by far the lion's share of the coverage across both print and TV. I've got the numbers down here. So the US had 30 articles, newspaper articles, whereas the UK had 87. And the US had 6 news broadcasts compared to the UK's 20. And you can also tell that even if you look at the news broadcast length, not only were there more news broadcasts in the UK, but they, on average, were quite a lot longer as well. Okay, so yeah, there's much more coverage of Working Group 1, quite a lot of Working Group 2 and very little of Working Group 3 on the TV. If you look at Twitter, there's quite a few interesting things to pick up on here. The first is, again, that pattern's repeated. Working Group 1 gets the lion's share of the Twitter coverage for the hashtag IPCC. Working Group 2 still gets a reasonable amount. Working Group 3, again, gets less. But I think what's particularly interesting is to look at people who are tweeting across all three working groups is actually very small. So the community of people who are interested across all three is pretty tiny, actually. And there's very little overlap between those working group communities of interest on the hashtag IPCC. Yeah, so this is just a visual representation of some of the front pages for IPCC coverage. You can see that none of them have any images in. Here's a LA Time, what's this global warming hiatus? Scientists give their starkest warning yet on climate change. From The Observer, the Sunday paper of The Guardian. Even The Guardian didn't have any images on their front pages, which is kind of interesting considering they're the kind of, they have the most coverage of climate change of probably any newspaper worldwide. And The New York Times here again, climate efforts falling short, UN panel says. So, yes?
Do you have a hypothesis as to why?
Yes. Yep, I'll come to that in a minute. Always good when somebody preempts your hypotheses. In fact, I think that's even written on there. Looking at the framings by working groups, there's a few different trends. So these are all Working Group 1, these are all Working Group 2, and the far right, yes, for you guys, far right, is all Working Group 3. I'm afraid I haven't got a key, but if we remember that this is settled science, political or ideological struggle, the role of science, uncertain science, danger, security, morality and ethics 1, so that's the kind of calling for action. Opportunity 1, action is an opportunity. Opportunity 2, don't take action. Economics 1, economics 2, and health. And for Twitter, which is all these green ones at the bottom, the NA is where we couldn't assign a frame to the tweet. I should say for the Twitter coverage, we weren't only looking at the tweet, we were looking at the hashtags because that's a way of kind of calling attention to an issue. We were looking at the mentions, you know, the @s, whoever names. We were looking at the profile of the person who sent the tweet and any link that was embedded, we'd go and look at the link as well to see if they were kind of endorsing it or not. So across Working Group 1 then, you can see that there is some consistency in the kind of frames that tend to get used across TV, print, and across tweets. Settled science is pretty common, as is political or ideological struggle, the role of science, especially in the print media, and uncertain science, especially again in print and on TV. Quite common ways of framing climate change for Working Group 1. When you get to Working Group 2, there's again quite a strong picture coming out that danger is a very common way of representing, of framing Working Group 2 coverage. Perhaps isn't surprising when you think of the kind of narratives that are contained in the Working Group 2 reports. And if you look at Working Group 3, bearing in mind, I mean, you can see that there's far less coverage overall. I should say also that we analysed 100 of the top retweets from the 50 most influential users. I can talk about how we selected those. We were looking at the most influential news sources, so that's how we also played across onto Twitter. So all of these add up to 100, so the unlike the print and TV broadcast, which give you a kind of sense of how much coverage there was. So it's not weighted for Twitter. So yeah, on Working Group 3, there's a real spread of the different frames that are used. Although there isn't that much coverage, we tend to see increasing use of those other frames, the more diverse frames like morality and ethics, opportunity, and so on. I should point out the one time the health frame was used is in print for Working Group 1. So bear in mind, the health frame you'd think would be a really common frame for talking about climate change, for connecting it with people's kind of everyday experiences, was only used once in the entire sample. If you look by media organisation, so you can see our different TV organisations there, and print along the bottom, different newspapers, you get a sense both of the kind of the coverage amount by TV. So you can see here, Channel 4 in the UK has by far the most amount of coverage, that grey bar behind there. And the BBC also has a reasonable amount of coverage. But if you look at ABC, Fox, MSNBC, NBC, so they're the US channels, very little coverage altogether. Those grey shaded bars at the back there. And if you look at particular news organisations, you can see that one of the particularly interesting things is the BBC compared to Channel 4 use of uncertain science. So this green down here, if you look up here, you can see the BBC used uncertain science a fair amount, actually. Of all of its coverage, it was given the most amount of coverage. Whereas in Channel 4, there was no use of uncertain science at all. And you can think why that might be. And I'll come to that a little bit later. If you look along partisan lines, you don't tend to see that so much in the UK on TV, but you definitely see it in the US around Fox Media, the only Fox News, the only article that they did have, only TV broadcast, was using uncertain science, which perhaps isn't surprising. Again, looking at print, you can see that The Guardian here has by far the largest amount of coverage, that grey total amount of coverage bar there. Although The Telegraph also has a reasonable amount of coverage as well. And again, you can tell the US newspapers here, very low amounts of coverage altogether, even across the broadsheets.
I just forgot, what's PIS stand for
again? So that's political or ideological struggle. Yeah. So that's kind of, yeah, framing things as a kind of struggle between people, if you like, or between nations, really giving them personality. Okay. Yeah, the last thing probably to point out is that sometimes, like if you look at The Telegraph here, it has really conflicting frames. So different news articles use frames that deeply kind of conflict with each other. So it uses both uncertain science and, in other articles, settled science. And that tells you something about the way the news organisation works, about how editorial control might work, and about how different journalists might have control over the news stories that they put out. That you might have one journalist who portrays the consensus on climate science, and other journalists who are very highly sceptical or contrarian, both working within the same news media organisation. So it kind of is a bit of a warning shot to say you can't, you know, in some of these cases say, oh, that organisation as a whole is highly sceptical or contrarian, because actually it's a little bit more diverse than that when you look at the individual articles. Okay, so going on to the conclusions then. Firstly, the three working groups are not all equally newsworthy. Working group one is consistently the most newsworthy, it gets the most coverage, yet it has a dominance of frames that we know from public engagement with climate change literature are perhaps unlikely to engage more than the kind of the usual suspects, if you like, the normal audiences for climate change. Working group two is pretty newsworthy, and that's kind of unsurprising because it has lots of discussion about dramatic impacts. That makes good copy, you know, having lots of images of disaster. It's dramatic, it's visual, it makes the news because people know how to tell that story. Equally, they know how to tell working group one story. It's often a fight between climate scientists and contrarians, for example. When it gets to working group three, though, it's consistently the least newsworthy. And I think we have some idea that that might be because journalists are not quite sure how to frame working group three. They don't really know what the dominant narratives are. They're not sure how to tell audiences stories about working group three. which in some ways is kind of surprising and perhaps is somewhere where the IPCC could look to improve in the future, because there's a lot of interesting stories in there, arguably much more interesting than Working Group 1 to your everyday member or the public who doesn't engage with climate science on a regular basis. You could talk about energy futures. You could talk about diet. Should we go meat-free? I mean, that's hugely controversial. We could talk about fairness and equity and how we discuss climate change proposed solutions. All of these things are, make, you would think, compelling copy. So why might this be? Well, the first hypothesis to answer your question is that there was a sequential release of the working group reports. So the first one, Working Group 1, came out in September 2013. Then there was a large break before Working Group 2 and 3 both came out in April-May time. In 2014, and actually their periods ran into each other. So the period of Working Group 2 overlapped with Working Group 3. So you could see that there might be a situation where journalists felt, especially for Working Group 3, that they had fatigue on climate change. They'd already covered the climate change story. How is Working Group 2 different to Working Group 3? Might also be that there's an element of translation of scientific writing into media narratives, and it might be that Working Group 1 actually did a better job on this. So they had a two-page statement of the key headline summaries issues coming out of Working Group 1. They were agreed by the lead authors, and that, even more than the summary for policymakers, made it into the media. So we can track particular words or phrases that were used in those in that two-pager that then made it into media coverage. And talking to journalists, they say, that was a really useful document. I'm not going to trawl through the summary for policymakers. That's 35 pages. And in fact, one of the things going through peer review at the moment for this special issue is about how impenetrable the summary for policymakers are, even though they're meant to be for non-experts. In fact, they've got worse over time rather than better, which is a pretty bad situation. So that translation from scientific writing into readily understandable non-expert language was done best by Working Group 1. So that might help explain it. And then the third hypothesis is that there's this idea of availability of compelling narratives and imagery. So to make a good TV story, you need to have good images. And having a bunch of scientists sitting around is generally not particularly interesting. Sorry. So having things like climate change impacts, having dramatic visuals is really going to drive a story and make it more likely to get coverage, especially on the TV. Working Group 1 and 2, they know Working Group 1, it's all about science, it's all about, often an uncertain science frame between one party and another. It plays into that journalistic balance kind of heuristic. Working Group 2 is all about drama and impacts. Working Group 3, not really sure what Working Group 3 is about. How's that different to the other two? Where do the compelling narratives come in? So it seems potentially there's a lack of understanding about what those stories could be for Working Group 3. On framing, we can see that different frames dominate across the different working groups. And you might think that's really not surprising. But I think that really is quite surprising. It's not inevitable that settled science should be used most for Working Group 1. There's no reason why you can't use settled science for any of the working groups. Any of those frames could be used for any of the working groups. Some are more likely to be used than others, I grant you, but there's definitely not a case that only one frame could be used per group. Some frames are rare. Things like opportunity, economic frame, the morality and ethics frame, they're all really rare. And yet, if we look at the public engagement literature, they're the ones that are most likely to engage non-experts with climate change. Now, of course, you've got to remember newspapers aren't out there to convince audiences of climate change importance or not. They're there to sell newspapers. They're, you know, commercial organisations on the whole. Journalists would say that they generally have their raison d'etre is partly to provide information and inform citizenry. So perhaps there is some more opportunity for these frames to be used. And lastly, why is there just one health article? There's been an increasing amount of work from George Mason University and others looking at why health is a really good way of talking about climate change, getting individuals engaged with an issue that affects them on a very personal level. And yet, it's only used once as a primary frame in our entire sample. Secondary finding is that different frames were used by different media sources. Again, you might not find this particularly surprising, but we think that the fact that only 5 frames were used in total across all TV coverage is kind of interesting. And it might be due to kind of journalistic routines. So the particular format, the media organisation format, so TV, print, Twitter, might favour particular frames. So, for example, in an opinion section of a newspaper, you're highly likely to get more political or ideological struggle as people talk about the kind of policy implications behind things or different policy actors. Versus disaster, which is, you know, this compelling kind of image-based story for Working Group 2 on TV. And lastly, media outlets favour particular frames. So as I said, the BBC uses Uncertain Science, but the Channel 4 doesn't use it at all. Well, Channel 4 is a commercial organisation, and in the newsroom, not on its other coverage actually, but in the newsroom, it's got a very strong line on climate change. It doesn't tend to have much room for climate change contrarians. The BBC, on the other hand, is an organisation that's a state-owned organisation. Its remit is to inform the UK public, and it has to tread a very difficult line between keeping a very diverse body of opinions happy, if you like, between climate change contrarians and very vocal, I don't want to say climate change believers, because I think that's the wrong term, but you see what I mean, across that kind of spectrum there. Last year there was a House of Commons committee report about communicating climate science, which criticised the BBC and its representations of climate change. Back in 2009, I think, the BBC did say, we're not going to have any climate change contrarians on anymore. They completely changed their coverage. Then Climategate happened. They got a huge amount of criticism for it and got told that they hadn't portrayed all sides of this particular story, and they've reversed that decision. So, different organisations have to struggle in different ways with this. So for future research then, well, the first is obviously, do these trends exist beyond the US and the UK? And I was talking to Alvin about whether this might exist in Australia, how would this look in Australia, but also beyond kind of Western news sources. So I'm hopefully doing some research in China, where we'll also be looking at the Chinese sort of version of Twitter, which is a Weibo, see how these things are represented there. There's also, if you think about the kind of news production circuit or circle, it's kind of an ongoing loop, if you like. It never begins or ends. What's happened before what's happening now is influenced by what's happened before, and what's happening now will influence what happens in the future. And there are 3 kind of different stages. There's the kind of moment at the top of the actual media representation, which is what we've been talking about, but there's also how audiences understand these messages. And there's the moment of the news production and how the news kind of comes into being, if you like. And we know very little about this moment here, about how news happens, journalistic routines. That's something that really needs more work. And again, we know relatively little about how audiences engage with different frames. So definitely opportunities for further work there. And lastly, yeah, as I was saying, audience studies examining the impact of exposure to different frames. So we're doing some work looking in the lab, changing some of those in the psychology lab, this is, changing how those articles are framed by changing the images or the headlines, for example, to see how people react under different circumstances to these frames. And also, we're going to be looking online, if you like, at a kind of natural experiment to see how these are disseminated, these different articles over Twitter, which ones are more influential, if you like.